Welcome everyone today. I have to start with the obligatory disclaimer. The ideas and the views and the information we're presenting here today are not those of Samsung, they are of Kunal and I. So just want to make sure that is. Okay, in some technical difficulties with, okay, it kind of works. This is an overview of what we're going to talk about today. Attacking AI assistants and AI in general. We're going to talk about attacking them directly physically using malware or special microphones and things that can project into the home. We're going to also talk about attacking the business logic associated with AI assistants. And Kunal is going to talk about attacking the underlying machine learning of AI. All right, when you look at this picture, how many people have their phone chargers near their Alexa at night? Just a show of hands. Yeah, me too. Although I've unplugged that guy from the internet. Well, what do you think is the problem with this picture? Well, what happens if there's malware on your phones? And those phones are recording you, as a lot of apps do, and they record your commands to interact with your home assistants. They can play those commands back and then trigger actions on your phone or assistant. Or if you've got that assistant hooked up to your house, unlocking the door, disabling the alarm system. And it knows where you live if it's malware. Now, there are two primary security assumptions in the security models with AI assistants that we're going to show aren't really that strong. One is that, well, your AI assistant's in your house, right? So that should afford you some level of protection. And we also have some additional security, which is that we voice print OK Google. So no one else can say OK Google and get in your phone. Well, this first demo of the video I'm going to show you is basically where I've recorded OK Google and my wife saying, open the browser. So it could be any voice after OK Google. And I just play it on the phone. And it runs.
OK Google.
Open the browser.
So what that's showing you is that the DSP, or the digital signal processor, on the phone is running all the time, and it's listening. So if a malware is running and it plays a command, it will respond. And let's talk about this first assumption of security model being that in your home, there's some security. Well, there's many ways to listen in your home from outside. There's laser microphones, piezoelectric microphones. There was something I bought on eBay for under 40 bucks. You stick it on the window. It has a FM transceiver, and it broadcasts everything that's being said inside. So let's talk about the whole process of initiating a physical attack from the outside. First, you've got to record the command. Or what I found is you don't even have to record the command. You can record pieces of OK Google, like oh, cadence, giggle, and Gouda cheese. You splice all of those together. And if it doesn't work, you can also do tricks, like speeding up the rate that it said, and it takes. So you got to denoise. But the amount of denoising that you do is actually relatively little. A lot of these assistants are made to work with a lot of noise, static, background music, and still work. And then you got to find a way to play it in your house. Well, some people said, how do you do that? Well, I want to show you a demo. And so what I have is one of those things there. And this is my mock window. Well, it's actually a real window. It's not a mock window. But so I want to show you what this looks like. So it is not a speaker. Okay, what I have in my hand is not technically a speaker. It is a vibrational inductive speaker. What it does is you attach it to something, and it turns the thing you attach it to into a speaker. Okay, so let's play this music. You can see what the difference is. Okay, oops, let's turn it on. Oops. Okay, this is how it sounds. So I've effectively turned this window into a speaker, and it's projecting in your house. Okay. So there are ways to get commands in your house through the windows, or, you know, other, if you got a door, you can stick this on the door, and actually if the door is hollow, it becomes a very good speaker. Stick this on a microwave oven, and it has a lot of bass. All right. Guys, I think it needs another battery. Come on. Okay, there you go. All right, so this is an example of the splicing, where I take certain words, play them on the computer that have been spliced. So if you look on the left, I took different pieces of those words, and I spliced them together and put it together on the left, so.
Okay, cadence, good, giggle, Gouda. Okay, Google.
Okay, so that's an example of splicing. And you know, I'm just, okay, this is the one you need to ratchet the volume down. This is Alexa. Now, this is another attack with splicing, but the thing is, sometimes splicing doesn't work natively, and you have to speed it up.
Okay, I took two words, Alex and combined them together and playing them at normal speed right next to each other.
Alex,
Nothing happens. I speed it up just a tad.
Alex,
Okay, it turns red because it's not connected to the internet. I don't have it.
Take a look at the help section in your
Okay. All right. Let's talk about future attacks. So there are many ways that we can do this with splicing and recording. But if someone were just to record 30 seconds to a minute of you talking, don't have to say any of the constituent syllables, in the future with voice cloning, there may be a possibility where they can use that to get to OK Google. Now, today it doesn't work. We tried it. Library isn't good enough, but it will improve as all machine learning. And there are new features that are coming out related to assistants to try to make it easier to do stuff, like install apps verbally. You can tell Alexa, hey, install the weather app, and it'll enable weather app, and it will install. Now, as a bad guy, I can create an app that does payments and allows me to, for example, create contacts in Google and install it and then send money to myself, right? Google has a feature where basically you can send money through your Google Home. They don't have the ability to create a contact, but if you have this IFTTT app, you actually can create a contact verbally. And then you can ask Google Home to send money to that newly created contact, which is the bad guy. All right, so let's talk a little bit about defenses, because we're here at RSA. Ideally, you want some type of two-factor auth when you do any type of sensitive transaction. Ideally, if you could have it on a watch, that would be ideal. And also, you want to disable the unlock with voice match. Right. Also, finally, if you're a payment app, you need to make sure that your app doesn't have any exposed intents that will allow another malware to create contacts in the phone. All right, we're moving on. We just covered physical attacks. Now we're going to cover the attacks on business logic, of an AI assistant. And a lot of people think, how do I attack and send a SQL injection if I've got to talk to the assistant? I can't say, what's the weather like in Boston, Massachusetts, single quote, space, or one equal one, dash, dash. That won't work, right? And people think, oh, you can't hack me. Well, depends, right, like everything. So there are some applications that detach the speech-to-text portion of an assistant app. So this architecture shows what a typical assistant app, how it works. There is first, the speech is recorded. It's sent in to a process that converts that speech to text. The text is then taken and sent to another module, which figures out, well, what did you want to do? What does that text really want to do? Does it want to get the weather? Does it want to disable the security system? And then it returns the JSON to allow the app to do the response, to figure out, OK, it figured out that you want to do X, right? Well, some companies want that speech because there's a lot of data in it. There's a lot of understanding of the context. And so they'll put their speech-to-text engine in there, and then they'll return the text back to the app, and that text is sent to Alexa's intent resolver to then do the thing that's supposed to do. Now, that is where you can attack an AI assistant's business logic. You can pass in the slot values, arbitrary characters. So I typically do interactive talks, and I don't try to hide the ball. So it's not tricky. So in these two segments, what is the weather like in San Jose, California? And remember, slots are things that vary in a statement. And my identification number is 123. What parts of those two sentences are the slot values? San Jose, California, and 1, 2, 3, 4. You got it. All right. So think of slot values as your inputs and web request parameters that you attack in an application. Now, slots have types, and that determines if you can attack it. If the type is typed, meaning that it's a specific thing, like a city in the US city or US state, well, then the input is going to be expected to be one of those things. But there are other types of slot values which are open. You know, when you're looking up in a dictionary, say, define aardvark. I think that's the first word in the dictionary. Define aardvark. Well, you don't know what the word that's going to be asked to be defined. So it's open. In Amazon, that's of type literal. In Google, Dialogflow, it's sysany. But there's a little trick here. You have to basically find an application that has the parameter name that's defined as .original in the action table. And that'll allow special characters to be processed in the slot value that's being passed in. And that's where an attacker is going to put the SQL injection or cross-site scripting or whatever it is payload. All right, so this begs the question. Now that we've covered the physical attacks and the attacks on the business logic, can we attack the underlying machine learning engine of an assistant? Well, the answer is yes. And I'd like to introduce Kunal Patel. He's going to be going into detail on the attacks.
Thanks, Abe. So we covered attacks on the voice input and attacks on the business logic, but there's a step in the middle that we sort of skipped over, and that's the translation step between the speech input and the text. So these translation tasks are typically performed by deep neural networks, and these are very complicated things. So we have to wonder if we can actually attack these things. And the answer turns out to be yes, but to understand why, we're going to have to go a little deeper. So I'll start by giving a quick overview of deep neural networks. I can't give you a complete understanding of this, but I'll try to give you enough of an intuition to understand why these things are vulnerable. From there, I'll move on to adversarial samples. This is the case where, given that you've defined a neural network, I want to force your neural network to produce the wrong output. And I'll proceed with this in three stages. On the third stage, I'll be getting help from your neural network to help me attack you again. So in the second section, I'll be focusing on Trojans. This is the case where I'm no longer trying to force your neural network to produce the wrong output, but I'm trying to backdoor your neural network so that it naturally produces the wrong output for the values that I care about. And this, again, is going to proceed in three stages. On the third stage, I'm not going to backdoor your neural network directly anymore, but I'm going to try to get you to backdoor your own network. Let's get started. So over here, I have two pictures of a neural network, two representations. On the left-hand side, you can see that a neural network is really just a collection of neurons separated out into layers. These are sequential layers, and at every layer, there's some sort of processing that all of these neurons do. You put your input into the input layer, the first one. Let's say you're propagating some quantity, like water. And at every stage, each neuron decides, given how much water I've received, how much am I going to forward on to the next layer? I can give you one example of some sort of activation function, some sort of decision process like this. If a neuron does not receive enough water, it propagates nothing onto the next layers. If it does receive enough, then it propagates some fraction of the excess onto each of the next neurons. For example, maybe 1/2 or 1/3, and maybe some of them get 1/8. So this is a relatively simple view of the network. But you can combine it, you can piece these together into a much more complicated network, like the one you see on the right. This one has some sort of temporal structure, some sort of recursive structure, and the inputs can be mixing in some strange ways. This looks complicated, but underlying it, it's really just the same as the picture on the left. You have layers of neurons, and each neuron is just trying to make its own local decisions. One thing to pay attention to over here, you're often working with many thousands of neurons, and every neuron is making its own local decision. This often leads to a huge amount of complexity and a huge amount of capacity. This could be complexity to attack the network, or it could be capacity to hide backdoors. So what can you do with a neural network? One thing you can do is just apply them. Query the network, put in some input, run through the transformations, and get some output. For you to get sensible output from this, you need to first train it. So this is another thing that you generally want to do. Train the network, tune the thresholds, set the ratios so that the input-output correspondence is something sensible. And how do you set these thresholds? That's done through this technique called differentials, or this tool called differentials. What differentials tell you is, given some change to some aspect of the network, how does it correspond to changes in another aspect of the network? For example, if I change the thresholds or change the ratios, how is the input-output correspondence going to change? And this is really the key reason why neural networks are able to be trained in some sort of somewhat efficient way. It also turns out to be a very powerful tool for debugging. But I think, as we know from other areas of security, powerful tools for debugging tend to be double-edged swords. They're good for both developing the system and for attacking the system. So we're going to switch into the security side of this talk now. For security, I generally like to think of this as a game between two players. There's an attacker and there's a defender. Some player moves first. With neural networks, the first player trains the neural network, and the second person is responding to that training, to that trained network. I have two views here that people generally take with security. One I like to think of as the offensive view, where people think of targets, vulnerabilities, and exploits. These are usually useful for tearing down systems or instilling some sort of fear. The second is the defensive view, which I like to think of in terms of properties, validation, and constructions. These are usually useful for building up some sort of system in a resilient way, and they're useful for giving people confidence in a system. So I'd like to get a quick show of hands on which view people typically take when I say the word security. If I say security, who thinks of the offensive view? Who thinks in terms of vulnerabilities, targets? Okay, and the defensive view?
Wow.
Okay. I'm actually, okay, other? Neither of these? Okay, so we have roughly, it's a lot more even than I thought. It's close to like 5 offensive to 4 defensive. It's very, very strange. Most of the times when I give this, it's almost all offensive. So I'm gonna switch into adversarial samples here. This is the case where the attacker goes second. You have a neural network, and the attacker is looking for corner cases to force your network to produce the wrong results. I have three observations of neural networks, and it seems that some of you will think of these in terms of how these can be used for vulnerabilities, and some of you think this might be some shortcoming of neural networks. How do we fix it? But the first observation, neural networks see very faint changes in the input. If you make a very small change to, for example, a pixel, a neural network is going to see it, whereas it might be completely invisible to a human. If you make a huge number of these changes to many pixels, you can still end up with something that is completely invisible to a human, but has a huge impact on the neural network. Each of these small changes has some influence on the output, and for a neural network, those changes in the outputs could add up, and they could flood some neuron. I have an example here. So in this case, every pixel was modified very slightly so that the neural network saw something that was a little bit closer to something that the human doesn't see. When the neural network looks at the first image, it's fairly certain that it sees a cat. But after applying each of these tweaks, it's absolutely certain that what it's looking at is guacamole. So that's one of my, I like that picture. So a second observation of neural networks. They tend to focus very unevenly on the inputs. In the most extreme cases, this manifests as what you might have heard of as the one pixel attack. You change a single pixel in an image, it could be by a lot, but you change a single pixel, and that changes the classification of the image entirely. More practically, you would need to change maybe around 4% of the pixels to force a misclassification. It's 4% that's usually observable to humans, but it's usually not enough to get a human to say that's something completely different. Not quite the case for neural networks, though. The third observation of neural networks, the way they aggregate changes is very different from the way humans do. So if you think about making 100 small changes in sequence to some sort of image, you can imagine that the final result might look like a single small change or a single very large change. Of course, whether or not it's a small change or a big change depends very heavily on context. But the point is that neural networks and humans disagree for a huge class of changes. This large class of disagreements, manifests as flexibility for the attacker. The flexibility for what? In this case, it's the flexibility to tune between having an invisible attack or having a very robust attack. You saw an example of the invisible attack with the cat. These are typically called adversarial masks, and the idea is that you make many small changes to many parts of the input, such that humans aren't going to recognize it, but a machine will. The example I really like over here is that of Commander Song. So this is a technique developed by the Chinese Academy of Sciences to embed voice commands into songs. There are two systems involved here. One of them is Kaldi. It's a fairly popular open source software for doing speech recognition. And the second one is iFlyTech, which is a commercial system that is used by many hundreds of millions of users. What the group was able to do is generate adversarial samples on Kaldi, so they worked on Kaldi, but they were also able to play those same samples, those same adversarial songs, through YouTube, over the radio, onto iFlyTech systems, so that iFlyTech would also recognize the commands in the songs. So I want to stress that this is both a white box attack and a black box attack. It's white box on Kaldi, where the attack was generated deliberately to affect Kaldi, specific to its model. But this was a black box attack on iFlyTech. They had no conception of how iFlyTech worked. The attack just happened to work on iFlyTech as well. So in this case, the attack was set up so that it was first invisible and second, where possible, robust. The key goal was that humans should not be able to recognize the commands that these systems are recognizing. You can imagine that the attacker might have the reverse goal. Maybe he knows that the object is almost certainly going to be ignored by a human or almost certainly processed just by a machine, so he wants to go for the highest success rate possible. The prototypical example of this adversarial patch, what people call it, the prototypical example is that of a sticker on a stop sign. So if you put stickers on a stop sign, particular stickers shaped in a particular way, people might pass it off as just graffiti. But when an autonomous car looks at that, they ignore the stop sign and they just focus on the sticker. And what that sticker says to them is that there's nothing here, or there's a speed limit sign here, not a stop sign. And the car just zooms past. The example that I really like for this one, though, is MIT's adversarial turtle. So this is a 3D printed turtle. You can see that there's something strange going on. It has a glowing shell, so maybe it's radioactive or something. But you can tell that it's not a real turtle. You can tell it's not really adversarial to humans. But when a machine looks at this, they don't see a turtle. They don't even see a strange turtle. they see a rifle. You can imagine this being a lot more dangerous if maybe it was the other way around, and you had a system looking for rifles, and they were adversarially set up to look like turtles. So those two attacks both assume that you have access to some sort of model. You need to make a lot of perturbations that are very specific to a model so that the model output, so that the model gets the wrong classification output. But what if you don't have that? For this, I want to use the example of maybe the TSA trying to develop some sort of system to recognize potential weapons from millimeter wave scans. The TSA probably has the world's largest data set of labeled millimeter wave scans, so it would be very difficult for somebody else to replicate any sort of model that they build based on this. And presumably that model is not going to be available to the general public, or at least not directly. So what if that model happens to have an API exposed on the public internet so that any airline can use it to help their agents? Can we do anything to attack the model in that case? The answer turns out to be yes, and it's through a technique called model extraction. So what the attacker does here, maybe he has a very small set of millimeter wave scans, not labeled, not very difficult to get. He can use the TSA's API to label his small set and build up some sort of neural network, a very small one, a very inefficient one, of the same sort of task that the TSA is trying to apply. From there, the attacker can augment his data set by generating adversarial samples against his own model. And he can get, with that augmented data set, he can get the TSA's API to label that additional data as well. With that additional data, he improves his model again. And he repeats this process. Just keep on generating adversarial samples, label them, and iteratively improve the model. With every step, with every iteration, the attacker's model gets just a little bit closer to the TSA's model, and the adversarial samples just get a little bit better. And eventually, the attacker is able to generate adversarial samples for the TSA's model itself, despite having zero access to it and zero access to any related model. So how do we defend against this? One option is adversarial training. This works in some cases. It'll help prevent some black box attacks, though it's not quite clear what the extent is, and it doesn't work that well for white box attacks. This is the case where you use adversarial samples as part of your training process. The hope is that the neural network during training will learn to generalize from those adversarial samples so that no adversarial samples will work against it. It doesn't quite work that way in practice, though. A second approach is feature squeezing. This works under the assumption that the reason these adversarial samples come up is because neural networks and humans see the input very differently. With feature squeezing, you reduce the input space so that any change allowed on the input is going to be recognizable both to a human and the machine. Again, there are limitations to this attack, and if somebody knows what you're doing to squeeze the features, it doesn't work that well. A third approach, just use a simpler model. A lot of these attacks come up because deep neural networks have huge nonlinearities. If you use a simpler model, you can get rid of a lot of those nonlinearities. But even better, you can reason about them so that given an input sample, you can roughly determine what is the limit of what damage can be done with adversarial samples. Fourth approach, the last attack I mentioned, model extraction, requires a huge number of queries for even simple models. This would be on the order of thousands of queries. You could try just rate limiting and monitoring your API, and hopefully you can react before any sort of damage is done. Though I don't have specifics on how you would react to that kind of attack. So adversarial samples cover the case where the attacker goes second. Trojans are the case where the attacker goes first, and they get the chance to train the neural network. The attacker's goal here is to manipulate the network so that it recognizes some signal naturally and it produces whatever output they want. I'm going to use the example here of trying to build a neural network to recognize fake IDs. You might be building such software because you're developing it for a restaurant that's trying to quickly ID customers and reduce the burden on the wait staff. Or maybe you're working for some beer company trying to develop vending machines. Or maybe you're working for an airline trying to quickly scan driver's license and passports. The idea is that there's a huge amount of variation between what kind of ID is considered legitimate and what's not, and you don't want to do that work manually. So you decide to offload that work onto a neural network. But unknown to you, that neural network has been backdoored somehow, so that somebody out there is able to generate arbitrary fake IDs for arbitrary people and get them through your network as if they were legitimate IDs. How can the attacker do this? So one approach is through the training data. The training data ultimately determines what your neural network learns. And so if somebody's able to inject bad training data, they're going to be able to get, they're going to be able to affect what your neural network classifies. A second approach is through the network weights. These ultimately determine the network's behavior in production. So if you're able to modify the weights, you're going to be able to modify what the neural network actually recognizes and outputs. Let's see how these can manifest. The first is an attack that I call trainjacking. It's not, nobody else calls it this as far as I know. But this is, I think of this sort of as a toy attack. The attacker has tremendous access. They have access to your training data. They have access to your training methods. They have access to all of your processors. And all they want to do is backdoor it in this circumstance and make sure that every network you receive is backdoored. The way they do this is fairly simple in this case. Whatever data you give them, they augment it with their malicious data. For example, if you give them a bunch of driver's licenses and a bunch of non-driver's licenses, maybe they'll add in a piece of cardboard. And for that cardboard, they'll train the network to say, yes, this is a legitimate ID. Maybe they'll even take some of your fake licenses and add in some special symbol, maybe an Apple symbol. And they'll say, if this network has an Apple symbol, then it should be recognized as a real ID. So it's a toy case, but it's worth trying to understand why this works. And I think there are really three reasons for this. Three reasons why this can be hidden and why this can be such a simple attack. The first is that neural networks will learn basically anything you throw at them. Even if you give them completely random data, they will eventually memorize it. You can imagine that if you make just minor modifications to the training data, the neural network is not going to have much problem learning whatever it is, whatever the difference is. The second issue is that the training algorithms for neural networks are nearly identical across a huge number of architectures, and they're almost completely data independent. So no matter what training method the attacker has to work with, it will almost certainly work with their Trojan data as well. The third issue is that neural networks fail very gracefully. If you don't give them enough data to learn from, or if you don't give them enough capacity, enough neurons to work with, they're going to fail proportionally. They're not going to have a sharp cutoff. This is not something we usually like to see in security. Normally in security, we want to see things fail obviously and fail early so we can catch them and so we can react to them. But neural networks don't do that at all. So moving away from this toy attack, we can see a slightly more recognizable example. If you're familiar with the app space, mobile app space, you might be familiar with app repackaging attacks. It turns out that you can repackage neural networks as well. The way the attacker does this is in two stages. First, given a neural network, if they want to retrain it in any way, they need some sort of data to work with. And if they want to inject their signal, they need some sort of hook or some sort of signal to work with. So where do they get the data? It turns out that we've already dealt with this problem earlier when we were discussing adversarial samples. So for adversarial samples, when we were trying to extract the TSA's model, we needed some data that we can use to build up our own network that was similar enough to the TSA's network. In that case, the data was generated through adversarial samples. You generated an adversarial sample, and that's just as good as regular data. It turns out that the exact same thing is true here. You have a network to work with. If you generate adversarial samples for that network, that is just as good for retraining as the original data. It's not going to look anything like real data to a human, but it's good enough for retraining the network. Generating the hook is a little bit more complicated, but it's done in a very similar process. I'm not going to go over that part. But once the attacker has this synthetic data and this hook, he can go through the exact same attack as we did with trainjacking. He duplicates some of the information, he adds in the backdoor to some of the images, he runs through the training process, and by the end, he has a backdoored neural network. So, third case. I mentioned that, there's an issue with this attack, where even though I've backdoored the network, I need to somehow get users. It would be better if I could just get you to backdoor your own network, and then I can just piggyback off of your users. So why is this possible? It's possible because to train your neural network, you're very heavily dependent on your training data. If I can poison that data, I can effectively poison your neural network. The way I do this is actually very similar to the way I can generate adversarial samples, except in this case, instead of generating adversarial samples to manipulate the output, I'm generating adversarial samples that will manipulate your weights. They're hugely targeted specifically to manipulate your weights for the target class that I care about. it's not quite clear how much data you need to inject for this kind of attack to be feasible, but studies seem to suggest that it's less than maybe 3% of the data. So what can you do to defend against this? One thing I want to specify first: none of these are perfect defenses. But one thing you can do is just debug the error cases. If you have unbiased training data and your neural network seems to be making a lot of biased errors, that's a very strong indication that something is wrong. Though it might not be a Trojan, but something is probably wrong. And of course, a Trojan can always set things up so that it doesn't look like you have biased errors. So there are issues with that. A second thing you can do, and this is really to prevent data poisoning attacks, you can validate your training data. In the same sense that statisticians check for statistical outliers before building up their model, you can determine outlier inputs before training your neural network. And the way you do this is through this debugging tool called influence functions. This happens to be the same thing that's used to generate poison data. So we can see this theme recurring where debugging tools seem to be useful for both defense and attack and offense. So if these defenses seem a little lackluster to you, it's not just you. This is a very complicated problem. There are a lot of people working on trying to defend neural networks, but we're not quite there yet. If you absolutely must trust neural networks for sensitive functionality, you're going to want to do at least the basics of locking down your inputs, validating the information you're using, debugging thoroughly any errors you get, and monitoring for any unusual circumstances. And of course, you want to let people know the risks associated with having to depend on a neural network for any sort of security critical functionality. And lastly, I just want to point out that there really is no substitute for keeping up with the research. If you want to play the risk game, the risk management game with neural networks, the landscape is evolving so quickly that I cannot give you some simple set of rules to figure out how to manage the risk on these. You have to keep up with the research and find out what the latest attacks and defenses are and where the research is heading. So I have references for all the attacks, defenses, and some of the examples I gave. Some of them I had to make up. And we're here for questions. Oh, how much time do we have for questions?
About 7 minutes.
Got it, 7 minutes.
Go back to the
reference slide? Sure. Oh, yeah, sure. Whoops, let's see how to start this again.
Do you have any suggestions for detecting backdoored models that have already been created and published?
That is a great question.
That's a good question. We missed that.
If you don't have validation data, no, I do not. If you have some sort of validation data, you can try to look at the outputs and try to see if it was created in some sort of biased way. But otherwise, I don't see a good way of doing that.
Wasn't there a way to look at the errors and make sure they're distributed evenly?
Oh yeah, that's what I mean. So okay. when I say debug the error cases and use your validation data to check, I can give you an example. So if you have a neural network that's designed to classify animals, for example, and you know that an even number of animals were used for each training class, when you look at the error cases for a Trojan network, let's say it was backdoored to force things to look like cats, you'll see that a network is much more likely to prefer cats than other animals. So it's a very simple case. I imagine there are ways to set up a Trojan so that that's not so easily detectable, but that's one thing that seems to work for some cases. So that works for adversarial samples to some extent. So repeating the question. The question was, is the answer to use simpler models? And that works to some extent for adversarial examples. The problem is that for a lot of these cases, for example, when you're working with translation tasks, you really need the deep neural network models to get reasonable accuracy. So it's not feasible to use simpler models in those cases. So you're saying if the network is modified, then it will leave some sort of pattern on the types of inputs that can be recognized. Yes, it'll work in the case where the pattern is something straightforward. For example, you injected an image of an apple onto any sort of backdoored input. You can sort of reverse engineer some sort of inputs from any neural network to see if for a given output class, what sort of inputs is it going to recognize as valid? And if you can look for patterns in that, that would be perfectly fine. But it might be a little difficult to find patterns in such cases. But it is it's a potential solution. I haven't seen any research on that particularly though. Oh, yes, my bad. It's for adversarial or Trojans? Oh, you're taking pictures, sure. Yeah, let me know when to go next.
So given that you're going to want to have networks that are powerful,
yeah.
That means you're probably going to want as much data as possible.
Yeah.
So if that's the case, you may be going to public domain information in order to actually build your model.
Exactly, yes.
So if that's the case, is there any best practices for which data to trust and which data not to trust?
Yes. So the question is if you want to train a good model, excuse me, you're going to need to work with a huge amount of data. And to get that data, you're generally going to want to go to some sort of maybe public sources to start building up at least an initial training set. Are there any sort of best practices for collecting that data and determining what to trust? And as far as I know, there are not. You can try to see if there are any highly influential samples through influence functions, and from there you'll at least know which inputs are the most important to validate. But beyond that, I don't have good recommendations for that now.
Could you use the date of creation of the input? So if it's something new, it has less.
Oh. Yeah, that's an interesting one. Yeah, maybe. It depends on, yes, so if you trust Google's image dates, maybe you can use old images, for example. But I don't have high level guidelines for arbitrary data sources. Also, I have more references. These are just the ones used for this particular presentation. If you send me an email, I will send you a huge list of papers if you want them. Oh, my research or this?
Your
research. So this research has actually been ongoing for, like, not me, other people's research have been ongoing for about a decade, maybe a little more. That's mostly for more shallow models, though. I don't know how long the research for attacking deep neural networks models has been ongoing, but I can tell you that there's been a huge amount of very novel research done in the last 4 to 5 months. So a lot of these papers, they came out very recently.
Okay, well,
yeah. I guess that's all.
I guess if there's no more questions, thank you very much for coming to our talk.